Good evening and welcome to You and the Law. I'm Mike Monda, your producer and host for tonight's program. And the topic we have chosen to discuss tonight is liquor control in the state of Ohio. Joining me as guests on tonight's show are Shannon Potts, who is an attorney with the City of Dayton Law Department, Mr. Scott Simon, who is an attorney in Columbus dealing with liquor and its control issues, and Mr. Peter Petitsis from Columbus, who is division counsel with the State of Ohio Liquor Control Department. Before we get to our panel discussion, let me remind you that You and the Law is a monthly presentation produced here at the studios of Dayton Access Television. DATV is on Channel 5. It's the public access channel of Time Warner cable network here in Dayton. The program is also cable cast on tape delay via the auspices of Time Warner throughout North and South Miami Valley Cable Council. The executive producer for the program is the originator of the show from back in the 1980s, the olden days, former domestic relations judge Mike Brigner. The program also streams live. You can get this on your computer live at datv.org. We are an audience participation program, and there is a telephone number which appears to be 223-5450, and I think we're also at 223-5311. If that's wrong, somebody will tell me somewhere along the line. We are also sponsored by the Dayton Bar Association, which was founded in the year 1883 and been service the community since that time. We'll talk a little bit more of that later. Bill Wheeler is the executive director. So let me turn to our guests at this point and have them more fully introduce themselves and tell you, the viewing audience, a little about their backgrounds and familiarity with tonight's topic. So we'll turn to Shannon Potts. Good evening, Shannon.
Good evening, Mike.
Tell us a little bit about what you do. And
sure. I'm Shannon Potts, attorney in the City of Dayton Law Department. I became a city attorney in May of 2005, and I've been there almost 7 years now. I've been handling liquor since April of 2006, and I'm excited to join you tonight to talk about that topic.
Thank you, Shannon. Let's turn now to Mr. Scott Simon. And Scott, you've come all the way from Columbus or nearby, and we appreciate the travels you've made to help us out.
Yes. Well, again, thanks, Mike, for having me on the on your show. I appreciate it. Again, my name is Scott Simon. I am an attorney in private practice in Columbus, Ohio. Concentrate my practice on liquor law throughout the state, representing permit holders. Formerly used to be the legal counsel and lobbyist for the Ohio Division of Liquor Control in the 90s. So my bulk of my practice concentrates on representing retail permit holders throughout the state, anywhere from liquor citations or trying to obtain a liquor permit, or representing a client if the city objects to a liquor license. So
okay.
Thank you again.
Thank you. And last but not least, we turn to Mr. Peter Petitsis, who is also from Columbus and division counsel for the Ohio Liquor Control. Peter, well, nice to have you.
Thank you for inviting me, Mike. I certainly appreciate it. As you said, I'm the lead division counsel, Division of Liquor Control of the Ohio Department of Commerce. I've been there since 1999. Before that, I was counsel for the Ohio Department of Development, and before that, I was an assistant attorney general for the state of Ohio. So I've been, since 1999, practicing solely within the area of liquor laws, and have enjoyed that practice very much.
Okay, thanks, and thanks for joining us. Well, why don't we start, probably our viewing audience is wondering why you can't just make your own liquor out in the backyard or something. Why do we need liquor control laws? Tell us a little bit maybe about the history of how we got started with that.
Well, the current liquor control laws really originate with the repeal of prohibition in 1933. At that point, the Liquor Control Act was put into place, and the idea behind it was that we are to have an agency which makes certain that people are producing and distributing and selling alcoholic beverages in a fair and a safe manner, so that there's not an abuse. We certainly want to, certainly always want to promote a responsible use of alcoholic beverages. So that is, was put in place, system was put in place in 1933. Another thing that occurred at that time when prohibition was repealed was that the amendment to the U.S. Constitution allowed each state to develop its own system. Approximately 19 states followed the lead of Ohio in becoming a so-called control state with regard to the high-proof spirituous liquor. Spirituous liquor is intoxicating liquor containing more than 21% alcohol by volume, so your higher proof alcohol is under more close control by the state of Ohio, as it is by, as we said, 18 or 19 other states. And in this system, the state of Ohio actually is the sole distributor of the spirituous liquor, and we actually set the prices for the spirituous liquor. We determine who's going to sell it, and they have, those folks have contracts.
So now
with
we
us.
Know. Now we know who's doing this, right?
So we're doing it for the high proof, and then for the for the beer and the wine, we simply regulate. But with the higher proof, obviously there's a greater possibility of abuse. So the state is more involved, and we more closely control it to protect, but also to generate revenue for the state of Ohio. These 18 or 19 control states, because we're directly involved, we reap the benefit of the profits from the sale. The gross income after all expenses this past year, the sale of the spirituous liquor in Ohio, the gross profit to the state of Ohio exceeded $200 million. So it's also a business for the state of Ohio in addition to promoting social responsibility. So we have a dual mission to obviously promote the sale of the spirituous liquor, but also to do so in a responsible and safe manner for the public.
Okay. Now, Shannon a little earlier said she handles liquor for the City of Dayton Law Department, I guess. Shannon, what exactly do you do in connection with the liquor control laws?
I actually wear three hats for the City of Dayton. I defend claims against the city, some civil litigation, and then handle liquor. And liquor is one of my favorite aspects of my job because I get to work with the citizens of Dayton. And I get to help them address issues that they're facing in their neighborhood that can sometimes be created by liquor permit establishments. So I work with citizens in trying to handle problems that are created by liquor permit establishments. They have three options in how they can deal with a place that becomes a problem. And one of those, the most common, is through the legislative objection. So the City Commission of the City of Dayton, being the legislative authority for Dayton, is the sole entity that may object to the renewal of a liquor permit, which it is a privilege under Ohio law, not a right to hold a liquor permit, and that's a privilege that has to be renewed on an annual basis.
Okay, and when you say you work with the public, is this the public who's trying to get the permits, hold the permits, or people who are involved, not necessarily involved with those things, but in the community around what's going on with the permits?
I'm most often working with citizens who seek to have a permit taken away. Now sometimes...
Okay, they don't hold the permit. They find something wrong with the permit holder.
Exactly. Now there are cases where I'll work with a permit holder or a business in the City of Dayton to try to facilitate, you know, if they need a permit expedited or something like that. So I do have the opportunity to work on both sides. And one of the things that I'm most proud of is when I started in this position back in 2006, the City of Dayton was objecting to about 16, 15 annual renewals of permits, and we're down to about five or six now.
Okay, do these objections come to you directly or to the law department?
Yeah, it's something that we're watching all throughout the year, and there's a certain time of year when objections have to be made. In fact, our citizen participation department is already taking feedback from citizens at the end of October on problem liquor permit establishments in neighborhoods So, but we don't actually have to be in touch with the state on who we're objecting to until the spring of next year. And we take feedback from any community stakeholders, citizens, and also our own Dayton Police Department.
All right, now we've talked about needing permits, and I think, Scott, this is where we want to turn our attention to your practice.
Sure.
And I'm assuming people would come to your office to find out what to do. Maybe they want to sell, maybe they want to have a bar or restaurant. What are we looking at here?
Right, correct. And when people, like I said, formerly was with the Division of Liquor Control, and then I've been in private practice for about 12 years now, representing permit holders. But as you indicated, Mike, you know, I may get a call, you know, every week, someone's looking for a liquor permit. And I guess just to back up, the state of Ohio, or the Ohio Liquor Control Act, ever since the inception, like Peter indicated, we've had what's called a quota system. So
what does that mean exactly?
What it means is the state can issue for carryout permits, one, and this is in the statute in the Liquor Control Act, one carryout permit for every 1,000 population or part thereof. So if the population is 1,001 in the city of Dayton, they can issue one carryout permit, or two carryout permits in the city. For D-class liquor permits, which predominantly are for restaurants, bars, nightclubs that allow for on-premise consumption for beer, wine, and spirituous liquor, it's the quota is one D1, D2, D3, or D5 liquor permit for every 2,000 population or part thereof. So the state created this quota system ever since the inception of the Liquor Control Act. And then over time, probably beginning in the late 80s, early 1990s, the Ohio legislature has changed that somewhat to create what are called quota-exempt permits, meaning if you meet certain requirements, the state can issue the liquor license regardless of what the quota is. But for the most part, there's a quota system based on the population of every city or township.
Yeah, the quotas are for what type of businesses?
Quotas for could be for carryouts,
mm-hmm.
Drive-throughs, could be a Kroger's, Big Bear, or Kroger's, Giant Eagle have predominantly carryout liquor permits. The D-class liquor permits, again, they're predominantly for restaurants, bars, nightclubs that would have a D-class liquor permit that allows for on-premise consumption. So
now, is there a quota for every type of sales then? Like so, only so many restaurants in town can have a liquor license, or there can only be so many carryouts?
There can only be so many liquor permits issued within every city and township throughout the state of Ohio.
Okay.
So city of Dayton, for example, I have what I brought was a quota, for example, based on the population in the city of Dayton. And the Division of Liquor Control updates their population figures by the Department of Development every 2 years. So their updated population figures, it's not based, you know, every 10 years, it's about every year and a half, about every 2 years, they update their population figures.
So that means if there's, we have a big burgeoning population,
then they can increase,
we can have another carry out in the corner.
Exactly.
Or something.
Okay. Well, you could have additional liquor permit can be issued, correct.
Okay.
The other means is if there's no permits available, for example, like in Dayton, for D1 permits, 72 D1 permits can be issued.
D1 is
D1 allows the sale of beer, only beer malt beverages, for carryout and or on-premise consumption. So a restaurant may have a D1 permit.
Mm-hmm.
72 or those liquor permits can be issued pursuant to the quota system in the state. 72 are issued. So if the idea is, hey, how do I get a beer permit if there's none available through the quota system? Then the other means is to see if someone within, let's say, for example, the city of Dayton may have a liquor permit in what's called safekeeping, that I can do what's called a transfer of ownership and location of that permit.
If what is safekeeping?
If basically, in the Liquor Control Act, there's a provision that says, look, if I lose my lease, if I'm a restaurant, I lose my lease, what do I do with the liquor permit? I can put it in safekeeping until, let's say, I have to find another location.
Mm-hmm.
You can renew it by statute once. The liquor department by statute will allow the permit to be renewed once while in safekeeping. So when it comes up this the second time for renewal, all liquor permits in Montgomery County are renewed every June 1st. So in Dayton, let's say the second renewal, my liquor permit's coming up, I have one of two choices. Either I reopen, which you can't do, obviously, if I lost my lease and I've got to find another location, or I can transfer my license, just do a transfer of location of it to a new new location if I found a lease at another building. So they let you escrow the license for a certain period of time. If I can't get a license through the quota system, I can't find a liquor permit from within the same political subdivision, let's say the city of Dayton, I can do what's called, and this was legislation created about 15 years ago, I can TREX, it's just an acronym meaning transfer exempt. I can potentially transfer a liquor permit from another political subdivision into the city of Dayton for an economic development mm-hmm. project. But you have to get the first thing to do there, you have to get the local legislative approval. So the city of Dayton would have to first provide either a letter or resolution to that proposed permit applicant, a letter or resolution saying they're not opposed to that transfer for this business, for this restaurant, for example.
Okay, so is that where Shannon comes in?
Right.
Okay, so what would happen then?
You know, I have to say, since I've been handling this in April of 2006, we've not done one of those.
So. Well, never mind then.
You know, we are, we're not at quota on anything but D1 permits,
right.
which is the beer and malt beverages right. Scott was talking about.
Yeah, there are openings for D5s, which allow you to sell everything in beer, wine, spirituous liquor for on-premise. So there are, I think, eight openings in Dayton. So if someone had a restaurant, had a building they wanted to set up in the city of Dayton, they could apply through the quota right now.
Now, do these applications, do they then go through your department?
Absolutely.
Okay, so Scott calls you up and says, I've got a client here who wants whatever. What do you all do then?
We want to make sure that we have the appropriate letter resolution from the city, that they do in fact agree that this is an economic development project that would be valuable for that city.
Okay, so they don't just go from his office to you, they go through
they would have to provide the appropriate letter from
municipal subdivision.
Yes,
or whatever.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So once we look at that, then we have to follow our normal procedures from there, which means we do still have to give notice to the political subdivision of the application, give them opportunity to object to the issuance of the liquor permit. And believe it or not, even though certain cities in the past have given us a letter saying that this is an economic development project that they support, when it later then goes before city council, sometimes city council will object to the issuance of that permit.
Okay.
So just because the city has endorsed the economic development project doesn't mean that they have waived their right to file an objection. And the objection may just be that they want to have some more information at a public hearing where the public can also speak to the issuance of that permit. Or maybe that they actually have changed their mind, so there's new circumstances, and they've changed their mind and they don't want to have the permit issued. If they file an objection, then we would conduct a hearing at the Division of Liquor Control. And by statute, that hearing has to be in the county where the permit would be located. So we travel to you. Our hearing officer has done hearings in all 88 counties in Ohio. So we travel to the various communities for the hearings, and the city has an opportunity to put on its case of why they believe that permit should not be issued if they filed an objection. On the other side, you have the applicant with their attorney can make the argument that they believe there is a good basis to proceed with the issuance of the permit. And we then make a decision. We issue our superintendent would issue an order. And we have to have a legal basis if we're going to support that objection, if we're going to reject the issuance of that permit. We issue a so-called rejection order. We have to have a legal basis for that. So that the city would have to make an argument that perhaps there is an issue with the ownership. Maybe the owners are suspect in some way, maybe criminal background or what have you, or perhaps they have operated liquor permit premises in the past in a manner in disregard of law, or perhaps the location itself is somehow bad, that location is a location where there have been a lot of other problems, that permit would cause neighborhood interference if it were issued. So then we have an opportunity to issue an order. All our orders at the division level are then appealable to what's called the Liquor Control Commission. Which is sometimes confusing to people because mm-hmm. both us, the Division of Liquor Control, and the Liquor Control Commission, both of our titles have liquor control in the name, but we're completely autonomous, separate state agencies. So basically, our decisions at the Division of Liquor Control are then appealable to the Liquor Control Commission, which is an autonomous state body, three members appointed by the governor. They each serve staggered 6-year terms. So every 2 years, a new member is appointed to that Liquor Control Commission. At that commission, basically, we would put on our case if we have rejected the issuance of a permit. Also, the applicant would put on their case. And they're an impartial body. They don't favor us just because we're a sister state agency. We have to put on our case just as the applicant puts on its case, and then the Liquor Control Commission would decide, if we've rejected the issuance of permit, they would decide whether to sustain that objection or say, no, we disagree with the division, we think a permit should be issued here. And they issue their own order, which is then appealable up through the court system.
Okay. Well, let's turn back to Scott here for a second, or more than a second, if you want to take that. Okay. And Peter and Shannon have basically outlined where you go with these applications, but when somebody comes into your office, what are you looking for in their makeup, their character, their business background, things that might disqualify them or qualify them?
Right. Yeah, that's a good question. What I first ask them, first of all, I need to know the legal entity that they, you know, are going to be the actual operator of this particular business.
Is there anything, it can go anywhere from a sole corporation then?
Right, correct. You could be a, you can hold a liquor license in Ohio individually in your individual name. Usually, majority of the time, most companies, whether carryouts, restaurants, bars, most of them have or closely held corporations or limited liability companies. So I'll ask them if they do have a legal entity, Mike, if by statute, if they have, who are going to be the members or shareholders in this particular company or business. If you have, in Ohio, the way the statute's written, if anyone has more than 5% interest in that particular company, that has to be disclosed to the Division of Liquor Control. So let's say there's two members of a limited liability company, each have more than 5% interest, they have to be disclosed. There's a form or on the application, their individual names are disclosed, who the actual members are. There's also background checks, two types of background checks. The local police, if it's the application's filed here in Dayton, the division will send what are called personal history forms to the city police department. They'll do their own local background check. In addition to that, the Division of Liquor Control will actually do a request, what's called an electronic fingerprint background check.
Okay, let me stop you just for a second. Our floor director tells us we actually have a caller waiting, and we'll get back to that in a second unless it takes that in. Good evening, you're on You and the Law.
Hi, Mike, this is Alec from Washington, D.C.
How are you?
I'm doing well, thank you. How about you?
I'm just fine. What question?
My call. I was listening to the discussion about the regulation process and the history of the liquor control laws in Ohio, which I thought was very interesting. It sounded like each of you panelists was a sort of a supporter of these regulations, obviously making your practices off of the regulations. And it sounded like you would oppose a regime that would make alcohol illegal in Ohio. And I wondered how you each feel about regulating marijuana in the same way that you're currently regulating liquor. To what extent do you think they're different? And are you guys working hard to make that happen in Ohio?
Well, it's a very interesting question. I'm not sure that, Peter, does the Department of Liquor Control have anything to do with marijuana?
No, we have nothing to do with, they have nothing to do with marijuana, and it, really it's not something that was within our purview or bailiwick, so really not an issue that we discuss, and it's not something that's come up in our deliberations regarding liquor, to be completely honest with you.
Okay. And I guess the question would sort of entail, would you regulate it the same way, or shouldn't it be regulated, or shouldn't we even answer that question?
The only thing I could mention, Mike, is I can't really speak to whether the marijuana should be regulated or not, but as far as liquor control laws, if you want to analogize it, since the inception or the end of Prohibition, obviously the experiment prohibition didn't really work. I think there were studies that more people consumed alcohol during prohibition than after it was regulated. So that experiment didn't work. But I will say this, all 50 states have their own liquor laws, and that is because of the uniqueness of the 21st Amendment to the Constitution. But it is a highly regulated business, the sale and regulation of alcoholic beverages, not only in Ohio, but throughout the other 49 states. Now, I don't know how do you compare that to regulating marijuana. I couldn't really speak to that, I guess. That's a public policy decision the legislature or the Congress would have to, okay. I guess, address.
Shannon, do you have any thoughts on this?
No, I agree with Scott and Peter.
Okay, well, does that answer your question or begin to answer it? Or it is difficult to equate something which is not regulated at all and may never be regulated to something that has a vast history of regulation, as Scott says, since the end of Prohibition. Do we still have our caller?
Well, I'm sorry, there's a little bit of delay here with my internet connection.
I think there's a 7-second delay, yeah. But go ahead.
I think my question is more, I think we regulate both marijuana and liquor. We just regulate them in different ways. We require a permit system for people to sell alcohol, and we put people in jail for selling marijuana.
That's true.
People who work in the liquor control business, how they feel about the way the different things are treated and whether they've given any thought, just personally, not as a public policy matter, but what their position would be on trying to regulate marijuana in the same way and achieving some of the benefits that one of the panelists was talking about earlier in terms of revenue for the state.
Well, that would be an interesting topic, but I don't think Division Counsel from the Liquor Control can give an opinion on that, whether he agrees, disagrees, or whatever. Am I right?
No, I'm not in a position to opine on that point.
Sorry we can't give you more than that.
Oh, that's okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Okay. Thank you for your call, and an interesting call. We have a little bit less than a half an hour left. We're going to take a very short break. There are no commercials on You and the Law, and we do come to you live and in color, as I noted earlier. We are talking about liquor control law and various aspects of that tonight with Shannon Potts, who is City of Dayton Law Department attorney, Mr. Scott Simon from Columbus, Ohio, who deals with liquor issues. And you don't have issues, liquor control issues. And Mr. Peter Petitsis, who is division counsel for the state Ohio Liquor Control. He's not on the commission, so don't ask any commission questions. I did want to let you know in this break, though, that we are sponsored this year, as we have been for many years, by the Dayton Bar Association, which is serving our community and legal profession for since 1883, which is longer than most of us have been in practice. The Dayton Bar Association does provide a number of community services, including lawyer referral service. If you don't have a lawyer, don't know anybody who can help you with that, you can call 222-6102 and they'll refer you to somebody who might be able to help you. We have a notary public service. Applications and testing, you want to become a notary, notarize people's licenses, whatever, they'll help you out with that. A really good program is with Heroes, where volunteer members of the association create wills, simple wills, for emergency first responders, firefighters, police, EMTs, and there's probably one coming up in November. I'm not sure exactly when it is, but if you call 222-7902, they can tell you that, or go on the website, which is www.daybar.org, and you can find out everything I'm talking about here, and probably more accurately. And they'll give you all that information. So that's the info on that. Our floor director tells us we have another call waiting, and we'll take that call. Good evening, you're on You and the Law.
Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Hey, I'm fine. Steve Seabolt here. I'm great, and I'm trying to stand away from my TV. I've never done this call in.
Okay, that's fine.
Potts knows me fairly well.
Well, that's an endorsement.
Well, I'm the chair of the Downtown Priority Board for the City of Dayton.
Okay.
Downtown, so we've had some experience with liquor
Do you have a question?
Yes. My question is for the Mr. Petitsas from the state of Ohio.
Mr. Petitsas.
And I guess my question is that going, you know, when a prospective permit holder comes for the liquor control board and also for the city of Dayton or the priority board or whatever, I understand, you know, they have to pass certain things, but I guess what does the state of Ohio really look at in terms of the permit? Because I guess my question is, and Shannon will back me up on this, is that we have situations where permit holders come, would appear to be in good faith and ask for a permit, but then once they have their establishment open, they sort of change the direction of what it is they're doing in their establishment. And I'm talking primarily about bars and clubs and that sort of thing. I'm not talking obviously about restaurants, where obviously one of the primary things is to serve food. But and I guess we've had several situations where we've objected some permits and the permits were still granted, and we had one case downtown where now after 4 years we went ahead and again objected a permit and the state granted our objection. And I guess it's a little frustrating when, you know, you try and come before the state and get the permit, you know, objected to, and yet the state goes ahead and
So it gets started off okay, and then things go bad, and you bring your case to them,
it's
and maybe
clear, and then all of a sudden, you know, they're doing something else. In some cases, they're bringing in promoters who have things.
Well, I think we have an answer for that.
Yes, absolutely. This is something that's come up over the years. Obviously, as you said, just because someone has good intents in the beginning doesn't mean that the business will go 100% according to their plans or our desires or the city's desires.
Right.
So in recognition of that, several years ago, we began a program of outreach. We, meaning the Ohio Division of Liquor Control, of outreach. We put on informational seminars to the various cities, townships, et cetera, local governments, to basically better educate them on how to put on a successful case before us, the division. And we've put an outline of that on our website as well, but we've gone out and we've done several of these seminars in the city of Dayton. Perhaps you attended one, I don't know. And what we noticed after we began putting on these seminars, that the cities were putting on much stronger cases. And I've looked at the data for the city of Dayton, the objections that have been issued from, the city of Dayton made to us to the issuance, renewal or transfer of liquor permits from 2008 through 2012, so a period of about 5 years. And in fact, the division sustained or agreed with the city 85% of the time. So that was not the case before we began putting on these educational seminars and started explaining what it is we're looking for. We provide helpful hints on what it is, the kind of evidence you need to present to us to be successful in a case. So we see that there is a high success rate statewide, but 85% in the city of Dayton, that's very much toward the high end statewide. So city of Dayton is doing a very good job in making us aware of when there are serious problems. And in fact, over the last few months, we've rejected the renewal of various liquor permits. I looked at the records over the last few months.
Well, we were very proud of Shannon and the efforts put forth by the community as well as the police department and citizens like myself. And Shannon worked very hard, and we have been very successful in objecting them. But I guess kind of going back again, we tried in one or two cases, we tried at the very beginning to object a license, and we were overruled, and then we had to go through this process. In one case, there was a murder at one of the clubs, and you know. So I mean, it's just a little frustrating for the citizens sometimes that while we do have some success here, and we had success several years ago with a club that finally closed down, it seems like it requires a lot of, you know, once a permit is issued, it seems like it requires a lot of effort on the part of the citizens of the city, and you know, to get this accomplished. But I understand everybody's got their rights when they have a permit. I understand that, and I respect rights, but But unfortunately, when things are happening that, you know, sometimes are, you know, are negative for the city and require a lot of police time and so forth, it does become very frustrating. So.
Yeah, I can understand your frustration. It is certainly a little more difficult before someone has been issued a liquor permit, unless they have a criminal record of some sort, or unless they have a history of operating a permit premises in disregard of law in the past. It's hard to necessarily put on a strong case up front. It's certainly easier, and the case law has shown this, it's easier to put on a case once someone has actually operated and you've seen that they didn't operate, they have not operated in accordance with the law. So I understand
right.
your frustration, but I will say this, that you know we've worked closely with you and with the cities to help you prepare and do a much better job and understand what we're looking for. And we in our view, things are improving in that matter. But as you said, on the other hand, we have to be fair and impartial. And in fact, the permit holders and the permit applicants are entitled to their due process rights. Due process means notice and opportunity to be heard. It's a constitutional right that they have the right to be heard before us. So obviously we've got to be fair and impartial to everybody, but the success rate of 85% is pretty high over the last 5 years.
And we're very pleased with the results we got this year, you know, and I think that's a testament to the city of Dayton and the people as well as the state in recognizing that when citizens have problems with liquor establishments that the state will respond. I mean, and I have to tell you that there was always sort of an old joke that was going around that once the state of Ohio issues a license that it's the old story that they supposedly the state of Ohio would love to have the revenue. Well, revenue from the license, but I don't think maybe that's really not the case.
No, that's not the case at all. I mean, we don't look at that at all.
It's a bad joke, maybe.
All right. Well, thank you for your call, and I think Mr. Patisse has answered that perfectly. But I did want to turn to Shannon, since you were mentioned prominently in that discussion, that you get. I'm echoing somehow here. You get the complaints about these things. What is usually the nature of these things? You're sitting in your office saying everything's going fine today, and then suddenly you get, I don't know if it's a complaint or whatever. What do you do? 'Cause, and let me ask this also. The owners of the licenses or the permit holders also have access to the website, and I suppose it tells them what they need to do. Am I right about that?
In order to
explain their case.
Well, it explains to them, you know, obviously the kinds of facts and information that would lead to them losing their liquor permits.
Losing, right.
So they're aware of that. So that's prominently on our website.
Right, and if they are represented, and most people probably are, if they're going to lose an important aspect of their livelihood, it's well discussed, I would imagine.
Sure, and they're represented by council,
yeah.
and they. But as the caller said, you know, the city of Dayton has done a very good job. I mean, Shannon is here, but I still want to thank her for the excellent job she's done in putting on.
It seems to be unanimous all over here.
Right, absolutely.
And I did ask you before, you know, taking the viewpoint of the permit holder, especially if it's an establishment that serves spiritus, liquors, is that the right term? That the owners say, hey, we run a great establishment inside, we can't help what's happening out on the street, the person who committed these heinous crimes was not intoxicated, we didn't think, and if we did, we'd cut him off or her off. So when you balance those, what are you looking for in making your recommendation then?
That's a great question, Mike, and it's a combination of things. It's a combination of evidence from police, and it's a combination of evidence from citizens. And I do want to say that we can't win any cases without citizens stepping forward and testifying. So people like Steve, who called in and all of the citizens from our priority wards and neighborhood associations play a very active role in the success of our cases. And so from the police side of things, it's often about the amount of calls, the number of police reports that are being generated at that specific location. And then on the citizen side of things, it's how this particular establishment is affecting their quality of life, basically, the environment that it's creating. And, you know, the case law says on that that it doesn't have to be a direct fault of the owner, that the environmental conditions alone, if significant enough, are grounds for an objection.
Okay, so you'd have to have kind of a range of incidents, you think?
Yes, so a lot of times what that looks like, you know, especially in the cases Steve, when he called in, was referencing are a lot of assaults, mm-hmm. sometimes involving deadly weapons even. And in other neighborhoods, it's not necessarily crimes of violence, but it can be things like the trash and litter. The place just isn't kept up, and there's public intoxication and public urination and things like that going on around the establishment. That's just not acceptable for any of our citizens to have to tolerate.
No, certainly isn't. Let me turn back to Scott for the news from the owners here. When they're approaching that and they're saying, inside of our four walls, everything is great. I don't know why people who are coming down here are causing trouble. What is the remedy, if there is any remedy? I mean, when you go before the board for the hearing, you're saying, well, we're doing fine inside. Is there something that they would be looking to do to alleviate the area they're in?
Right. That's a good question. I mean, that's what from the retail permit owner's perspective, if I'm a nightclub owner, they're going to say, look, I can control, for the most part, the clientele that I have inside the establishment when they leave or they're going down the street. I don't have the ability to control every facet when someone leaves or goes down the street, if there's an assault or some other type of a crime committed, why am I solely responsible for that? What I would suggest is that the permit holder should try to work with the particular legislative authority, particularly, you know, if they're hearing concerns like in Dayton. Different cities have different neighborhood associations in Dayton's called priority board, right. But my suggestion is they work with that particular neighborhood group in the city to see, to try to work out what, to address their concerns. I think taking a deaf ear from a retail permit or saying there's no problems, that occurs from a patron that went down the street, that's not my problem. I think that approach is the wrong approach for the retail permit holder. I think my suggestion would be that they need to work with the local legislative authority to try to address their issues. Sometimes I think they can, other times, depending on the city or the legislative authority, sometimes it's difficult to address whatever particular concerns the city may or township may have. It is difficult. I mean, it is like Peter said, I mean, that is a, you know, from my being on the government side and then going in the private sector, I mean, it is a person's livelihood, whether it's a carryout or a restaurant or a nightclub. For the most part, a lot of people try to do a good job. I think I would emphasize, you know, training. Department of Public Safety will come out free of charge to do training. There's also other people throughout the state. There's liquor law consultants that will come out and try to do training for permit holders. I think that's always a big thing, and no matter what type of field you're at, is continual training of the employees, educating them what to look for.
Yeah, do you think sometimes maybe some permits shouldn't be in some neighborhoods? They're just it's just a bad location, or maybe the neighborhood turns bad, or something like that. Does that come up? Because obviously, if they've got it in the first place, somebody must have thought this is an okay location. Now, there's one area downtown which was recently closed, and I think it's gone through two or three owners in the past 10 years, and it's a prime location, and they just don't seem to do well. What do you think? You know the area.
You're talking about was most recently Hammer
most
Jackson.
Most recently Hammer Jackson. It's down near the bus station, the parking garage, and a lot of retail establishments down near the gym, and where you were a boxer at one time. But what do you think?
What do I think about the location itself? It's just,
I mean, is that typical of a location? Is it a location problem, or do we just keep getting a bad atmosphere? I mean, you're directly involved with it, so.
Well, as you know, we have high demand for residential in downtown Dayton right now, and it's growing. And so that creates a sensitive situation. We need business owners and especially bars and nightclubs that are going to be respectful and sensitive.
It's not the Wild West.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Or Girls Gone Wild, which was the case with Hammer Jacks in 2004, I think, right? So, and that was before my time, but of course when I was preparing for the case last year, I looked at the history of the place. And
so in this case, maybe the neighborhood got a little better because it's more residential, do you think?
I think that the neighborhood's improved, and then especially since that permit has been removed. So
okay.
We're grateful that the Division of Liquor Control sustained our objection on that one, as Steve said.
I take it from our discussion, though, that most establishments, when there is an objection to them maintaining their permit, are going to get every benefit of the doubt. Just because there's citizens' complaints or municipal complaints or whatever doesn't mean you just say, okay, you guys don't want it, we're taking it out.
Well, I would say we look at it right down the middle. We don't necessarily favor one side or the other.
Well,
in those
I thought
situations.
I just said that, but that's probably a better way to
Yeah, we look
to
at
put
down
it.
The middle. We look at both sides, and we look at all the arguments, and we look at all the factors. For instance, because it's a bad neighborhood, as you say, doesn't mean that there might be an operator who could come in and do a much better job than people have in the past. We see that sometimes where someone comes in who is much better at running a liquor permit establishment, and they can have a very successful and clean operation where others have failed in the past. So we will look at that, and we're not anxious to take certainly anyone's livelihood away, but if the circumstances warrant it, we will sustain an objection to the renewal of a liquor permit.
Well, let me go back. I know we were talking earlier about qualifications and things.
Yes.
And what we're looking for before we try to get a permit for any number of these things, and you know, some people say, well, how come I can't buy liquor over here at the store and I can buy beer and wine or whatever? Are you able to predict with any certainty after a discussion with your clients as to whether your permit is going to get granted?
Have a problem.
Yeah.
One thing I'm glad you asked that to dovetail back into that about qualifying or applying for a liquor permit. And this applies to whether you're transferring a license or applying for a new permit. One of the things I wanted to touch on was every city and township are broken down into local or precincts. Each precinct has their own way of to self-determine whether they want the sale of beer, wine, spirituous liquor. So you could literally be one precinct, maybe wet, what's called wet, meaning the voters allowed the sale of beer, wine, liquor, and there's all kind of variations, Mike, as far as different local option questions. You could have a precinct literally right across the street that's completely dry, and you get all kind of variations. For example, like on Sunday sale, you might have a permit or can sell beer, wine, liquor, everything on Sunday. Permit or across the streets in a different precinct, but they're completely dry because they're in a different precinct. Each citizen, each registered voter that lives within each precinct has a right to self-determine whether they want the sale of a particular type of alcoholic beverages, whether it be beer and wine for carryout, beer and wine, spirituous liquor for on-premise consumption. So what I was going to mention, you asked that before, was when someone applies for a liquor permit, one of the things the permit holder applicant wants to do, I know of a place that was in the national news in Northeast Ohio a couple years ago where they built this huge facility And what I was going to emphasize is that you have to also check what's called the local option. So if I'm applying for a liquor permit at 100 Main Street, Dayton, Ohio, you want to make sure, is this precinct wet?
Right.
So let's say there's an opening for a permit, everything's processing fine. You don't want to expend hundreds of thousands of dollars on this building, renovating it, and then once you get through the process, and it takes about, I tell people about 8 to 12 weeks is the average time process for a liquor permit. Let's say there's no problems with their background checks, that's okay. But the liquor department will, here's what happens, the Division of Liquor Control will send to the County Board of Elections, in this case Montgomery County Board of Elections, ask for what's called the precinct history. And they're going to ask the Board of Elections, you tell us at that address, 100 Main Street, you give us every precinct that address has been in from the inception of Prohibition from 1933 to the present date. The liquor department will then have to check their local option records, and they probably have the most comprehensive local option records throughout the state. We have 88 boards of elections, but a lot of them have different, their records only go back so far. So the division will check every local option vote, the registered voter, the voters in that particular precinct, whether they approve the sale of alcohol. There's a variety of questions from 1933 to the present date. So you want to make sure, is this precinct wet before I expend, you know, thousands of dollars putting, renovating a building or even purchasing a building. And that's what happened in Northeast Ohio. Someone expended literally probably $500,000 and then found out halfway through the process that this precinct was dry.
Yeah, you always hear these, I don't know if they're horror stories, but somebody does that. They say, well, we're opening up a restaurant, and then the next thing you know is they're telling their patrons, well, we haven't gotten our liquor license yet, and from what you're saying, it may be very likely they didn't check, and they're right. Not going to get one ever because right. it doesn't qualify.
What I tell people, Mike, if there, for example, there's opening for a permit, apply immediately.
Right.
You can get on file with the division. The division will send out the information to the local Board of Elections. Board of Elections will then send back that precinct history information. The liquor department will check their records. That's the only way comprehensively. You can, ahead of time, the person himself or herself can contact their local Board of Elections and say, hey, I'm going to be locating or interested in putting a restaurant this address, is this mm-hmm. wet or dry? A lot of Board of Elections, I don't rely not necessarily on that alone because their records may only go back so far. So I always tell them, let's get the application on file. There are also people out there that do check, will check for you or try to ascertain the local option history is what it's called. But I always like to tell people, let's get an application in process, cross-check the Division of Liquor Control records, because I've seen situations where the Board of Elections may, because their records only go back so far, might say this precinct is wet. Once it goes through the process, mm-hmm. when the division checks their local option records, it comes back saying, no, there was a vote in 1965. Oh, our records only go back yeah. to 1975. Oh, okay, it's dry. Mm-hmm. So that's why I tell them, you know, you don't want to expend a lot of money. You want to make sure also right. through this whole process.
Seems you know, prudent to right. check first and open up later. So.
And I have some applicants that, you know, it turns out it's wet for everything Monday through Saturday, dry for Sunday for, let's say, spirituous liquor. It's yeah. wet for beer on Sunday, but dry for wine and spirits. They have the ability to put a local option question on the ballot, mm-hmm. Go through their local Board of Elections. You have to petition, and you could either put a precinct-wide local option on the ballot to vote the entire precinct wet, or you could do what's called a site-specific local option, whereby the registered voters of that precinct are just voting that particular address wet, which is more palatable a lot of times to voters.
Yeah.
So that's more popular.
But we're down, our floor director tells us we're down to our last minute. I do want to ask one question, and you brought it up before, and this will be a quick answer question.
Sure.
Tell us what proof means.
What proof means?
Yes, you said something about 21.
A proof is basically
content
if something,
of alcohol.
Something, if something is 21% alcohol, that's considered 42 proof. You basically double the alcohol percentage, and that's your proof. So
okay.
20% alcohol is 40 proof.
Great. Okay. Well, we've come to the end of the line here. I think we've run out of time. It's been a great discussion, and I'm honored to have all of you as my guests. Shannon Potts, City of Dayton Law Department. It's great to have you. Scott Simon from Columbus, attorney in liquor issues, and Mr. Peter Petitsis from Liquor Control. We always say that on You and the Law, we bring the greatest legal minds in our area, and I think we've done that today. So this has been a production of You and the Law. I want to thank all the volunteers behind the scenes who have made the program possible. We got one day before the election, so get out and vote, no matter who. We've been talking about liquor control. Thank you for joining us. I've been your producer and host. I'm Mike Monda. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you again next time. Good night.